listening stuff. This is our last episode of the spring. We'll be back at the end of August. And so, I hope you enjoyed the program so far this year. And today we'll be talking about bees. And we have one of the bee families that's a wonderful guest for the second half of the program. If you don't know my background or haven't watched the show before, this is a live broadcast. And you can call in with any questions about gardening. 1-800-339-1113. I'm a plantologist and I'm a certified arborist. I currently work in Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture, where I run a diagnostic laboratory for plant diseases. So I have a long history in taking care of landscapes, working with plant materials. And if you have any questions about your garden, call in, tell us what you're growing, and we can talk about how you enjoy your garden or any problems you might be having. So, we always start our program with upcoming events, and we have a number of events coming up in the near future. Let's take a look. We have Creating a Wildlife Habitat with Natives coming up on May 8th at the Manhattan Beach Botanical Gardens in Connecticut. This is a wonderful small garden, and their classes are free. This class is from 10 to 11 a.m., and you can call 310-546-1354 and let them know you're coming, because they do limit how many people can attend their classes, although they are free. Wonderful program to visit. In addition to that, they have a successful succulents class that will be on May 15th. And again, call them up, let them know you're coming to that event so they can plan for how many people will be there. And our next event will be the 36th Annual Spring Plant Sale. It's coming up on May 15th and May 16th at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. The members preview sale is on Saturday the 15th and is open to the public on Sunday the 16th. So if you're not a member, this is a great time to go get a membership so you can get in on the sale early. It is 10:30 to 4:30 p.m. both days. I will be giving talks there on both days, on May 15th and May 16th. Although I don't recall the specific time, I believe about 11 on Saturday, maybe 1 o'clock on Sunday, but if you come, I'll pretty much make the most of all the time. If you want to come by and say hi, it's a nice small little show, it'd be a lot of fun. But if you have any questions you want to bring some type of plant sample to show me, that would be a good time to catch me at the Huntington Botanical Gardens and you'll plant some. And let's see, we have another event to talk about, container gardening with natives. This will also be at the Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden on May 22nd from 10 to 11 a.m. Again, their number is 310-546-1354, and you do need to let me know you're coming. In addition to that, let's see, we have Palms and Cycad sale coming up on Saturday, May 22nd, at the San Diego Botanical Gardens. And Palms and Cycad have wonderful plant materials for your garden. They're really unique materials, and really almost signature type plants for Southern California. If you haven't grown them or don't know about them, you can go down and talk to some of the experts from 9 to 3 p.m. on May 22nd. San Diego Botanical Gardens, Farm Coast Wind Gardens. And if we have another event, let's see, getting rid of your water guzzling lawn, which couldn't be more important, and I did that myself. This will also be at Manhattan Beach on May 29th from 10 to 11. I just got rid of my back lawn and I'm turning it into a vegetable garden. So, nothing makes more sense than getting rid of your lawn, especially in Southern California. They guzzle water. They use 3 to 4 feet of water per year in a hot river valley, a little less than that along the coast, and even more than that in upland deserts. So I strongly encourage people to get rid of their lawn, especially from the front lawn or home after using it. It's just a big green square you look at when you come home. And you can have a big green square of iceland or ground peppers that farm or drought tolerant. So it's a good idea to get rid of your lawn. Now, there's a couple things I want to talk about before we talk about the bee family today. I want to talk a little bit about what you can be doing in your own garden at home, particularly for vegetable gardening. You're going to talk about vegetable gardening all this year. So let me start with my plants. My tomatoes and peppers, for the most part, back in mid-March, and so they've been in the ground about 6 weeks, and now it's time for them to get assigned dressing before planting. After your tomatoes reach about the 4 to 6 week stage, and now they're up about my knees, it's a good time to fertilize them again, give them a little bit of food, high phosphorus, high potassium type of blue fertilizer. You look at the plants, they look at very dead, like 30% nitrogen in soil fresh. It says, as you're passing your daily load fresh, about 12 inches away from the plant, and your fertilizer in that trencher is called side-pacing. And that's a little bit better way than just broadcasting underneath on the surface and scratching. And I would recommend you use them on the side of the plant, which is under cottonseed meal. Or some of the plants with cottonseed meal, a bone meal, bone meal, a falcon meal, they last longer and decompose slower to a base than that. So, you know, what else is really talking about is the cottonseed meal and what's that for you, some of your nitrogen. The other thing that's really important to do, and if you haven't done it already, is to mulch your garden. So, the weeds are starting to turn in your soil, you planted all your plant materials, you've got those seedlings coming up and all around, especially if you use a sprinkler to get the whole area wet. You have a lot of seeds, variety of annual plants coming up, grasses, other invasive kind of plant materials. And if you cover the soil with a thin layer of mulch, you know, 2 to 4 inches thick, you can compost is excellent, or even just straw. Straw is good, or even wood chip. You want to cover it pretty thickly so the slow evaporation from the surface of the soil can allow you to water less frequently, which is really critical to growing healthy, vigorous plants. You don't want to water frequently and shallowly as bad for the plants, but deep water. Right now, I'm watering my plants about every 7 days. It's been cool. Sometimes I've gotten as long as 10 days. But we're supposed to warm up this week, and I'll probably go up to 70 season. If we get really hot in July, I'll go up to about maybe, because I'm going to have a thick mulch on there, I can probably keep it to once a week. Good deep mulch. Now, if you're growing things like bush beans or corn, you want to plant them in succession. If you planted corn about 4 weeks ago, now it's time to plant another block of corn. If you've got space for that, you know, corn requires quite a bit of space. You need to plant a 4x4 foot square of corn in order to get good pollination and good ear development. So if you've already planted that, now you put in another block, and then you'll get the harvest over a longer period of time if you plant in succession. You can do the same thing with bush beans. And I prefer bush beans over pole beans because I don't have time for the structure to support them. And this is something else to build in the garden. So if you're planting in succession, it's time. But the other thing I want to absolutely tell everyone is not too late to start your vegetable garden. Get out and get started. You'll still get a great harvest of whether you're putting in your tomatoes and peppers and squash or whatever you're growing right now. Now, one of the things I want to talk about today is our general lecture is going to be pea family. And it's pea family, it's trees, two vegetables, and it's the technical name of the pea family is Fabaceae. It's the third largest of all the flowering plants. It is incredibly important economically because of peas and beans. Now, there are a number of very important specific peas, particularly soybean and Pisidium sativum, which is the term bean plant. And then Glycine max, of course, is soybean. Fusilis are the beans, and Pisidium are the peas. There's also chickpeas that fall into the genus Cicer. And there's alfalfa that's also in the pea family. And then peanut is also in the pea family. So you can see it's a pretty big family. And a lot of big trees too that are in the pea family. Sativum is the common pea. Pisidium sativum is an annual plant. It completes its life cycle in 1 year. And it is really a cool season crop. So things like sweet pea and sugar snaps and that type of pea, it's too late to plant those. You can't plant them now. They won't do well. I wouldn't even try and grow it once I was right on the coast. And it's not a good thing to plant now. You want to plant them. If you want to grow peas, you need to plant them in the fall. And the earliest you can plant them really is about September 15th. And in fact, if you want to grow sweet pea, you also have some pictures of sweet peas in there, which are just fabulous. They set in beautiful colors, make great cut flower. If you want to grow sweet pea, get it in about September 15th, or at least the last 2 weeks of September. You'll have flowers by December. And that's generally true of all the peas. Don't get them in that early fall. just fires and they're not in beans. But bush beans will come up and get a good hanging crop. And then when you water, there's another a block of them that's going to come up in 2 or 3 weeks and start bearing good crops. So plant them as seeds. Getting back to kind of the history of the whole thing in beans and lentils, they actually were one of the important parts of the diet in Europe in the Middle Ages. They ate a lot of beans. They could be dried and stored for a long time, so they were very popular. By the 16th and 1700s, they became popular to eat them green before they'd always been dried, and they'd cooked rather than eaten green. And then, of course, you have to eat them very mature in order to get into that bottom of beans maturity, into that full maturity. The new pulse parts of the peas were developed by the English during the 1700s. And you can go to garden peas or English peas. Prior to that, people really didn't eat fresh peas. And the popular peas that spread in North America, and Thomas Jefferson grew more than 30 pulse parts of peas on this estate. So peas go back in the early American tradition in that sense. And of course, the small peas and the sugar peas, and of course, when you eat the whole pod, and you pick them when they're very young and mature, and they're very popular, and of course, the Asian cooking and the Chinese and stir fry and things like that. So, there's a number of really interesting things about peas, minimal. For extreme genetics experiments. These are in essence the father of modern genetics, and it's all based on this pea work. And it is what they call outdated genetics. And of course, use the standard pea, the same sativa, with those characteristics. And you can use sweet pea in the same way. Now, if you do grow sweet pea next fall, remember to cut off the flowers. As they bloom, you don't want to let the flowers produce the pods. You let the pods mature because then they stop flowering. Or you have fewer flowers. So as soon as they come up, they're really looking good. Collect it, they're very fragrant. And they bring cut flowers to bring in the house. And then you'll keep getting more and more flowers. Now, I'll show you how they're grown in this. Let's see, we have the farther of all the rows, the sweet pea rows, from the ground. And I'll start here, and let's bring that up full screen. And you can see why the sweet peas need to be supported. And you can either use a plastic netting material and hang that between sticks, or you can see how elaborate this particular setup is. This is actually a commercial pea flowers, pea or sweet pea flowers being grown, and cut cut flowers. There is a really popular tree, and there's a number of really popular trees that are in the pea family. And if we could look at the Olson tree, let's bring that up also. There is the Olson tree, and this is just an easy out around Southern California right now, very popular tree. Albizia tulipus. It has really pretty pink flowers that come out in June, and they are deciduous, so they don't have any flowers on them, or they don't have any leaves on them during the winter months. And now they're just easy out, you can see moving out around town. Let's go to the close-up. This is the next picture of the flower itself, also flower. You can see it's very quite open flower. And you can also see the typical leaves on a pea plant. The leaves on peas are either once pinnate or twice pinnate. In this case, they're twice pinnate, which means they're broken up into leaves twice. And this is one of my absolute favorite trees. It only gets to about 30 feet. It makes a broad dome, and it's very, very light. It lets a lot of sunlight in underneath it. So you can actually grow this in a long, long easier. You can grow a lot of it in a long, that would shade out the lawn. Another popular tree is grown in Southern California. This is the pea family. It's Tipiwaukee Tipi. Let's take a look at that. A lot of people don't know the name of this tree. This is Tipiwaukee Tipi. This is a little tiny one. Tipiwaukee Tipi can get to about 34 feet in height. Unfortunately, there's a new pest on Tipiwaukee Tipi. And it's the Tipiwaukee Tipi psyllid, and it's causing problems. Acacia is also very how proteins and cichlids and patient flowers. This is also in the pea family, and those leaves should give away because you can see that it's that they're bending. And the flowers that you actually look at more closely, you realize that those are in the pea family. Corn vetch is also in the pea family. Let's take a quick look at that. And this is common vetch, and that is the typical pea flower. And the other one that is in pea flower is also clover, which is a trifoliate. And this is clover, and this is also in the pea family. And clover, of course, is well known and used extensively. And for cover cropping or growing in between rows of fruit trees, you have enough rain and you don't have to water too much. Well, because of where you are with the diseases, but you grow in between rows, and you can turn it in, and it adds a lot of nitrogen to the soil because it actually makes nitrogen roots with the rhizobium. I'd like to remind everyone that we are live, not the air, and you can call in at 1-800-339-1193 if you have any questions about your garden, or if you are interested in specific plant material, we can talk about it, how to grow it, how to water it, fertilize it, prune it. Because of all we talk about earlier in the show, apples, diseases, and trees to grow. Now, right now, I'd like to go into a little bit about container gardening. If you are limited in space around your home garden, one of the things you can do is grow a lot of your plants in containers. You can grow beans in containers that are quite well in containers, especially bush meat. So, let's take a look at this video clip about growing in containers, and we'll come back. We'll have an interview with our guest.
Gardens are a really good option for gardeners who don't have a lot of space in their yards. You can plant pretty much anything. You can plant in a brown bed inside of a container, put a heck of a patio boom on your deck. Any place where you couldn't garden in the soil, you can still garden in a container. First thing you have to do is select your container. There are a lot of different container options out there. Many of them are very decorative. What you want to do is select what size container we're going to use, and that's going to then dictate what plant species we can pick and what kinds of soil we're going to stick in the container. The other thing you don't want to make is you don't want to fill up your pot with garden soil. Garden soil is great in the garden, but in the container, it doesn't drain enough. Let's illustrate why that is. A shallow container holds lots of water if it becomes a swamp. If you have a media that doesn't drain well, in a deeper container, we're going to drain more water out of the container. So in a shallow pot, you want to use a good, well-drained potting soil. In a deeper container, you can use a potting soil, but you can also mix a little bit of regular garden soil in if you want to. So you've picked a good, great commercial potting soil. We're going to fill the pot up about halfway with potting soil. You want to make sure that you leave enough space in your container. And have a potting soil plants that have been growing at up to this point. Now let's make some plants to go in this container. You've got a lot of choices when you pick your plants. You can use anything that you can grow in regular garden. Two species that we are going to use in this particular container are the Dever and the Yarrow. We're going to put the Dever plant in the middle of the container because the Dever plant is obviously a bigger plant. And then we're going to add some marigolds. Marigolds are a nice choice for this. They've got a nice sort of color to them. They aren't going to get too big. Now what you want to do is fill the rest of the container up with potting soil. It's just about ready to go to its final home in your yard, your patio, on your deck, wherever it is that you're going to fill. The last thing we need to do with this is to go ahead and water. So this is where this works with watering. Get a good drink of water so that it gets a good start. Start by picking a nice container that fits in the location where you want it to be. Second, fill it up with a good quality potting soil. This one is in the container. Water it very well to get the plants well established, and then finally pick it up and carry it to wherever your final home for it is, and enjoy it for the rest of the summer.
Welcome back to the Gardens of California. And that clip was, really helpful clip that talked about growing in container gardens and around your own home. And a lot of people who have limited space in a small backyard and don't have a lot of full sun Texas, and you have a dream, and you have a day, but day area that's in full sun. And those are great places to grow things in a container. And my experience is always not as big bowls, but I promise you, if you go in a little deeper container for my things like peppers, they dry out too fast on me. And so I'm going down to a plastic container than clay. Clay dries out so quickly. And a little deeper container, a little deeper soil. I like to use, bag mix. Any of the major manufacturers will be fine. Bendini, Scott's, or just a local blend. Be careful when you're growing in a container not to use a pine mix that has too much wood chip in it. Wood chip or a lot of cellulose, that can be either as wood chip or it can be sawdust, whatever it is. For the first few weeks, when you mix it into a soil, as it decomposes, it's going to lock up all the nitrogen. And you're going to have a nitrogen deficiency. It's a brief induced deficiency. And so if you put in that type of very inexpensive pine mix, that's all lizard, it's a lot cheaper. You have to add a little nitrogen to it. You need a little extra nitrogen, and you might even want to let it sit for a week or two before you pot it up. And that way, you'll avoid that nitrogen-induced nitrogen deficiency from putting too much wood into the garden. That's also true when you're planting your vegetable garden. If you mix in a lot of coarse material that's not well composted, then you can have this brief nitrogen deficiency in the last couple weeks. I did that once. Now, before we go, I'm going to turn the gas on, but we're going to have one in a minute. I want to show you a problem that occurs on aloe, and this is probably aloe, I forget the arborescence, and you can see this gall that occurs on the lower part of the plant, and this gall is caused by a mite, the aloe mite. It's a group of mites called the areophytid mites. The areophytid mites are very, very strange little mites. They're four mites instead of being. Mites are related to three cells. You see the damage on the leaf that it causes a severe fall. This is what happens in first row. There's no treatment for this. You can't go get this grow back normal. You can get a miticide and treat it, but really it's mostly a fall and there's no safety. It doesn't get on all the aloes. There's a lot of different aloe species out there. There's tree aloes, there's the broken aloes. This is all arborescence. It's got the spiny edges of the leaves. And it grows a pretty good sized clump. But most of these low growth aloes, aloe striata, and this one aloe arborescence, will get this mite, and then it causes a severe gall. Once you get it, you might as well throw those out and try and prevent it from being spread to other clumps of the aloe or other aloes in your garden. If you go to the arboretum or any of the botanical gardens where there are lots of aloes, they very, very nice and display some variety of species. From the tree species like aloe magnesii and aloe barlothii, which are tree aloes, which don't get this way. But the low growing ones do. You can see this all over the plants of the aloe tree aloes. And so you'll know what it's causing it. They don't really have a control for it because they're missing anything for it. Now, our guest is ready to come on the show now, so we're going to go to another video clip on container gardening. So enjoy this clip, and when we come back, we'll interview our guest.
Extension, and Amy, tell me what plant we're going to be containing today.
Well, we're going to plant some pansies in this clay pot.
Oh, really? And what's the first step?
Well, the first thing I did before I came here was clean out this clay pot. These are strawberry jars, and they've been used in the past many times. And in order to prevent plant diseases, well, I bring these in and scrub them with a hard brush and clean them with a little Clorox solution. And it kills any bacteria and problems that are in there. And let them dry. And so then after that, we're ready to start. And so the first thing I'm going to do is, first I should tell you that when you're doing container gardening, anything can be a container. If it's plastic, plastic will hold the water better when it's hot and dry. So if you have a plant that likes water and likes to be damp, plastic would be a better choice. Clay, these kind of clay pots, they like to be, or they will dry out because they're porous. And so oftentimes, in the heat of the summer, you have to watch, you know, these a little closer to make sure you get plenty of water. And the most important thing about it all is to have a hole in the bottom. I don't know if you can see that there. To have a hole in the bottom so that water can drain out, because we don't want it to stay in the bottom and cause problems with the roots. So, first thing we're going to do is we're going to...
You have a rock, yes.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to put the stone in the bottom of the pot.
So there's a hole in the bottom.
Right. And to keep the soil from running through until it has a chance to pack in there, you can use a stone or a broken piece of pottery or even a coffee filter, and some pots will work just fine. And so now we're ready to put some soil in.
Okay, and you tell me how much we need to fill the soil.
Now I want you to go to about the first bottom of this pile right here, the first bottom.
I'd be able to do it at about 3 scoops.
3 scoops.
And working people pick up soil like this.
Well, your garden center has good quality lime soil. It's best to use a potting mix like this. And it's better to use a potting mix than it is to say, like, use your garden soil, because there's microorganisms and insect larvae and that kind of thing that could be in there.
Did you say that's about enough?
I would say it's perfect.
It's starting to come out the sides of it.
Right. I just had to tone that down a little bit. And now.
Welcome back to Gardens in California. My name is Gerald Turney. And this is the program where we talk about all things gardening. And today we have all for our guest, Al Ritter, who is the executive director of the Community Garden House. Is that right?
Yes.
And along with Herb Gardner, obviously.
Yes.
And you also manage directly the Salon Oak Canyon Garden?
Yes, that's my home garden.
That's your home garden?
Yes.
How is your garden? Tell us about your garden.
Well, my garden is 5 acres, and it's an erosion control project that we worked with the Environmental Protection Agency a number of years ago. We built it. And inside that erosion control project, there is a community garden of about 35 gardeners. One agribusiness that we have, it's called an aerial farm.
Okay.
And then we have an orchard, so that if you're on the one down through, you're going north out of that second tunnel, you're going under our orchards.
Oh, really?
Yes. And most people don't realize it, but it's there. And then we have one Mexican farmer from central Mexico who permacultures our balance of the farm, and it's very good. It's wonderful. You really produce a lot of food.
And do you grow your food, or are you mostly for your own growers?
Well, the community garden people, they get their own food. The permaculture person, I try to encourage that one to grow into the food chain. And at Livenberry Hill, we're working on a pretty new program. I would call it a restaurant-supported agriculture system. We haven't really developed it yet, but we're working on that. And then the orchard is just an orchard. That's a wonderful orchard.
What do you have in orchard? What kind of fruit trees do you
grow? We have pomegranates, we have nectarines, we have oranges, tangerines, wire lemons, regular lemons.
Organic basis, or do you strictly start your own organic?
Very, and we would
not so. The calendar word particularly is very faulty. And a lot of research that came out of UC or some in our lab showed the damage to citrus from calendar. But I was never really quite sure about the status of horse manure. Is horse manure particularly, you have had a problem with that with your horse manure?
We haven't had a problem primarily because we only incorporate a fertilizer, and this we think it's fertilizer. We only incorporate that in the composting process. So that when compost is put on, it's never really hot. It's definitely cold and composted into the mechanical composting system. It's from the inside. We have 28 compost piles in the
compost piles. So just, do you have all the sides built in, or do you just have one of those?
We're going to be very fancy when we start. So yes, we built in the sides, and it does work. When you have an enormous amount of compost piles like what we have, you have some that are full, some that are half full, and some that are nearly empty that you're going to be using. So we tend to plan in them, even during the time that they're composting down. So we grow all in all spaces. That's really one of the fun things to see is things going into the compost pile.
Do you turn it by hand, or
in the technical area, you turn it by hand. In the just the normal area where we let it degrade for a year, it's you know, we do plant there. Yeah.
So you just pile it up, but that's not the right system, by the way.
You know that there is a formula for compost, and it's the 60-30-10, and so, yes.
So, what does that mean, the 60-30-10?
It means that it's 60% carbon, 30% nitrogen, and 10% ether, which is your fertilizer, your starter, that needs to be for your critters to be in there to help decompose the pile.
So, you add your horse manure into it?
We add it in addition to.
Okay. Yeah. So you add regular fertilizer?
No.
No cotton seed meal?
No, not yet. When we get it done by this point, when we get done with the system that we have, we'll probably test it to see what we are missing in our thing.
So you come down, you close the hour.
It's going to be compost, it's going to be the minerals, the minerals, all this stuff that we want. But for sustainability purposes, you really need to do 60% carbon, 30% nitrogen.
And so from your
community? Yes.
So in order to get that 30% nitrogen, do you select certain things to go in your compost pile? Or do you like a lot? Because we're talking about, I'm starting with these, that's what I mean, if you have alfalfa, it's fairly high in nitrogen.
Yes.
That would be a good source to keep your nitrogen level hot.
Right.
But do you grow that, or do you grow any alfalfa or anything like that? Or?
Well, alfalfa is really on its own in our garden because basically we 365 a year, it's just warm all year long. Yeah. Now we do have the sweet period between July and September. You just keep things alive as opposed to eating much. But after that, yeah, you have to do it from that point. And you plant certain things to give you the produce, and then they're to be used as carbon. Carbon is fine if you really don't have the most of it. If you really have a good, we have a restaurant. And so our nutrition food is really pretty pure in that respect.
So you're going to use a lot of restaurant waste in your most part?
It's wondrous food. It's all we can do. You would be surprised how much if the restaurants themselves separated, because these people really do work with us and they separated. And even oils, they bring the unwanted vectors, just put it that way. Not necessarily things that wouldn't be in a field compost, but you just really don't want to encourage them.
So, what are you doing with kind of your standard nutrients right now? What are you doing with your tomatoes? And what do you have for your vegetables and your
vegetables? What I like to grow, say, at home is different than maybe what I grow in our little farm thing where we're
working on the rest of the day.
The overdue specimens.
It's popular too.
Yes. And my favorite is I like celebrity.
It's
very common, but it's grows really well. It's a nice tomato. I don't necessarily like to grow the heirlooms.
Have any problems with your lawn spot?
Well,
because I have that problem myself. I've got a few heirlooms. I've got green zebra, I've got a purple cherry, green, and things like that. And I'm noticing on some of the heirlooms now that I'm doing a lot of research. So I'm cutting those leaves off as quick as I can. And it seems to give me a little bit of control rather than trying to go with a copper spray or something organic. I think copper spray is would still be the plus size organic because copper is a considered death.
At this point, we were a little bit late. We had 5 weeks because it was stewed over a little while, and it was a bag full of problems, so you really have to deal with it. So we were, my garden's a little
longer, but you for 5 weeks.
Wow. It was the experience. Hispanic gardener reminded us that we can do this and I should do all the time. They're not nearly as big, but they are in. We pretty much have them in. We have in peppers right now, the very last where lettuces are coming out.
Yeah, lettuces, you're about to fall to
fire. Yes, and then the last of the potatoes are coming out now. We did a little rush of finger lace to turn on flower beans, of course, some of these restaurants have never had really decent flower beans. And we do Italian kale, which is just beginning again. Peppers, like the little yellow, some cherries that I don't know what the little cherry ones. I like them. I like the cherry tomatoes as my favorite nature. And the green grapes. Now, the median of those others. I saw one, it's an orange, I don't know, it's an orange heirloom, and I wanted to grow a nice orange tomato. They were the size of a bean. They were like sugar, but they were the size of a bean, and I also said, I hope for
them. So they were different kinds of tomatoes when you grow this.
I think we had a lot of time this time.
Not a whole lot.
Because we go primarily from our restaurants.
So you still already do have a good girl or a bad girl?
Yes, we do. We have some beef steaks. We have Roman's out with an
interview. Roman's fire. Roman's great.
Wonderful cooking.
Wonderful cooking to make.
And eggplants, beets, carrots, lard, lots of char. They're starting.
As you know, our viewers just a minute ago, that it was time, maybe if your plants have been in about 4 to 6 weeks, they're starting to get about knee-high, good time to cypress. You wouldn't bring in a fertilizer and cypress, but would you come in when they're about at the 4 to 8 week stage and do the tools left?
Yes, yes, and also, in some cases, we start seedlings ourselves because it's really cheap and easy. When we do that, we always top dress on top of what you plant with and so forth. We always top dress with that. It's used commercial then as well as the ladies' columns on the end. We find that one is probably as close to what we will take on your property. This is not made by us.
It's not a job for a bunch of
people. We are directly involved, meaning
it's not the grumpy variety. It's not a good idea. If I were a girl, a better boy.
Yes.
Because I have my own reason for really tasting
it. Yes, you know, you can put it in a keeping comment. Yeah, and we're going to do well for you. I'm not just successful with the degrees.
I struggle with the degree. I haven't done it. That's what I'm going off for in the past, but I haven't done it.
And I like the idea. The dark room has the dark tops, too. It's made from purple Cherokee scoop.
There's quite a few. You see the chocolate brown.
Oh, yeah, it's the chocolate scoop.
Yeah, they're all delicious. I want to have 35 to 8 places in the
world. I want to do that. Okay, exactly. There are other things we need to grow.
But if somebody's out there who wants to get into community garden, you want to get a plot, what's the first place that you go? Should they go to Yvonne's website, or do you have a website that they can go to?
Oh, yeah, a website. As well as the UC extension. But the UC extension will tell you is the nearest garden to you.
Okay.
And then oftentimes those gardens do have a website that gets you, like ours, we have a website that gets you into it. And then they can always go to our website and you'll see.
What's your website?
It's the LA Garden Council.
LAGardenCouncil.org. Are all any of the community gardens listed on your website?
But they are on Yvonne's. They are on Yvonne's. They're all volunteer organizations, so we don't function quite like the big ones.
It takes
a little more to do all the work.
So you can sit on the team to get on to you're one, there's someone who
yes.
Has 35 plots.
Right.
And so your wait is to get on the community garden website.
Every garden in the city has a waiting list. There is a waiting list, and we open a garden. There is a waiting list. A couple of gardens rotate, meaning you can come in and you get to be a community gardener here for 2 years, and then you have to give up your plot for a year, and then rotates. There's some of them that they've been trying that.
Also helps set up
meetings. Los Angeles, the city of, in this case, but we now restrict ourselves to the city only. But Los Angeles City is, in my opinion right now, it's the only city in the United States that we need to use money out of their CDBG money, the Community Block Development Grants, and which is WIC, Section A, food stamps, those programs, we convinced our city council there to take a small, tiny little portion of that to give us and let us create community gardens so that these people have access to fresh food because of the food deserts that you know exist in the city. And these groups, we are delivering gardens every year in this city, and more we are putting fresh food.
So what's the city you're looking for people who want to help organize water?
It's all of these.
Bring all together in order to create a new community garden.
Right. So you can always go to the website, send an email to me, or call us. And yes, we do. That's what I
think. The hardest part of it is the land. Finding the land first.
Finding the land is usually hard. Getting the land is hard.
So you can find it if you want it.
But you can't always have it.
And then you want to get it and use it, and that probably is
your
limiting factor.
We've learned over the years how to assist the local group to get that land. A lot of cases,
devices,
right? And we provide them with templates on their organizing rules, the application for the garden rules itself.
What's most of this land? Is it mostly the city on land? Is it part of the old land?
I try to get as much city land as we can.
It's easier to get it from the city side or the city.
You tend to be able to lose it faster.
That's true. Because they're confident of some point they can turn it into some type of revenue for themselves rather than letting people just
grow. In many cases, yeah. So that was the 41st Chanel Amina.
Yeah, so it's very fun.
That's right.
But I don't know why I'm an idiot. It's his name. He's going to bring up your luck to where he wants
to. Right. Yes. So, yes.
Is it shady to keep Is fairly small, and then you need very large subgroups in order
current status is a vegan person.
Is that Pearson's?
Yes. Is Walmart?
Yes.
Good to hear.
Yeah, this is great.
But the power company wanted to move out and put that storage units in.
Yes.
And we really got it because the power department's in the storage units because the board from the structures in the power lines. Because they want to fight fires in the power lines.
Out in the valley, in the San Fernando Valley, it's one of those where they want to listen to the million companies to support their crops and all that. There's no sense in there. They don't want to listen to the gardens out there. So,
I'm sort of that too. Because, it took the fire department a little while. Is it a county fire, or is it a county jurisdiction, or whether they're working with local city fire departments? But I know that they're concerned that some of the workers are going to move off because they had planned storage units up there. They moved off the storage yard years and never got even built. And now that land is vacant too. So,
what happened was somewhere, I'm not sure, because we had some problems with it too. Usually hired out our people with the UWP here or Edison or DVC. And what it amounted to was, I think there was a major shift in some policy. And we had installed things like their approvals and they didn't all out.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
And I think that some of your nursery people, they have things that are quite bad. One of them was the reason it was metal for grounding from underneath the power lines. And I think with those nurseries, they are very ill in their operations. And they practically eliminated them. They just put plastic units took out those loose containers and industrial containers.
Yeah, they're only allowed to have non-permanent offer. The trainees are often destroyed. And then most of the growing grounds is plastic pots and plastic irrigation equipment.
And it's only that too.
So, what else is new for you and Gardening? How long have you been gardening? And how have you been gardening a long time?
Well, I was born on a farm. And I spent probably the first 8 years, 9 years, learning a lot.
Where were you from?
So far.
In Illinois.
Yeah. About 100 miles west of Chicago, 100 miles east of the Mississippi, so right in between.
So, you've been doing gardening your whole life?
Restarted.
So when did you come back to gardening?
1994, recovering from a heart attack. And I was still getting bangers and they were doing some work and I just watched them on a regular basis as I walked by and I finally had some of their previous talking with them. It was remodeling community garden. Really, I mean, I was challenged like I'd never been challenged before. And I gave them the usual excuses that I can't do this, I can't do that, I've done a lot. But, I surprised them as much as they surprised me going back because I knew they were
so getting bangers brought in
the community. Absolutely, they changed my life. Our whole thing changed theirs and they got me. It was one of the most wonderful experiences of my life. It made me believe what I was doing.
So, where are you most of your recovery? Is it from the real plants or is it from your system community working with the other gardeners?
It feels pretty close. I do value my time alone in my garden, and I think it gives me time to think, and you get to see the processes of nature taking its place, and you get to see all of those things. But yes, I do love interacting with people. Sometimes I can express my opinions pretty good, sometimes not. It is really an enjoyable part of it.
Did you ever go through Yvonne's Master Gardener training?
Oh, yes.
What series did you do that?
2000.
Okay. I do a lot of the season in the community garden. Over your own, you're talking about your goods.
Yes.
You're volunteering all your time. Strategies you use in your organic control. You do use some of the systems and you use those and so sort
of. Yes, so I do use the like the Dr. Earth. They have some things like the life of a couple. There's a few products that I like. Dr. Earth is one of them. Like I said, we have started tracking
the gophers. Oh, the gophers are tough. The gophers are really tough.
I call them tree rats and squirrels.
That's it, you know, you're wrong with the energy squirrel being a fox cat.
Yes, yeah. And we were seeing more than 15 feet from our peach tree, you know, which is why at the point of being right
now.
And the squirrel just comes in and goes right across the outside of his carrying his big old peach right in his mouth and just looks at you and then just runs on.
So you're dropping for those, or how are you fish with them? They're pretty expensive.
Yeah, I think you are chased off this year. Many. When we used the netting the last time, goofers nice big caught up in it. And that's a real ordeal for to get them because they can make themselves so small they go through some of the things and stretch. And the next thing you know, they can't move and they're just like,
they're hurt. Goofers nice big caught up in the bird.
And they have that little black.
Probably haven't seen
it. No, we where someone calls us and from saving the bees. I mean, you and I talked about the bees the first time there. From everything we talk and discuss now about, this sort of clear position is whatever we can do to make community learning more viable in the city.
So, after you started, since you started with community learning in 1994,
yes.
And then you went through Yvonne's
course.
Now that you're involved, you have a group of gardeners. Or you have a small home, so your community garden is
considered very large, but I consider it small. Okay. I have a postage stamp front yard in which I have one persimmon tree, and I have one star fruit from Indonesia. I'm trying, and it's a struggle.
Later, 4x4 area, then when you can harvest your corn all summer.
We have our plan this you asked us today that I consider myself a foodist. We do divide into quarters, and you know, I was born in that way, but yes, that's part of the plan. Carrots right now, we planted a mass of carrots. And we're going to take the first quarter of carrots. Sugary sweet, and we'll know where the carrots are. And we want to lose a quarter, then we plant that right away. But the next quarter, we will take the next section of carrots, and they're going to be longer, they're going to be 2-3 inches, they're going to be just as sweet, there's going to be more of the rest of the water with lobsters. But you can do that, you know, you can stagger carrots, you can stagger onions, you can do some peppers.
Do you grow all the whole head with me?
Yes. Yes.
Do you stagger your roof beans too? Because I've always done that in my garden, staring
at my roof. 2 to 3 weeks will be ready to list this drought. And most of my students, I see me in this area, so they're pretty. And we can keep them all down from being the other ones. But yeah. And we're buying the purples this year.
Oh, yeah, those are kind of fun.
Yes, and you can cook them in the morning. But if you don't cook them, like they use with the green salads, they still use the purple. Yeah, they're bumpy. And they're really, really delicious.
So I'm not even buying some peppers. A lot of pepper. We'll see for how long you have some hot ones too.
Well, when you have peppers or one thing, cheese or another. We do have the bells, and we have the cherry reds, and we have some jalapenos that we use to learn. And we are doing some of the chilies too.
A lot of green. Are you trying to color up how you manage your peppers?
They begin to let you know when they're ripe. Peppers will tell you basically after you're with them a lot of, they'll tell you, look, I need to come off now. And
we're colored up a lot.
Right. Because sometimes they're green. And if they're going to be a green pepper, they may get a little black streak in them, and they'll tell you on the sides or on the edges. It just got a little. It's time for me to be picked. The beautiful reds, you don't often do that because you can let the red go and go and go and really become the herb. The poblanos.
Yes, the poblanos. I have a few.
It's too early for poblanos.
I think it's too early. You know, it's
well, yes, you can. Yes, you can.
It's been in my peppers in bar 15, thinking, okay, I gotta get them in.
Okay.
In these cold nights, I was a little worried that they're gonna be hurt for the whole season because. Got down to the
I-40. And I was praying for that rain.
This is making cold because we've been in the water.
Fortunately,
I've never seen you.
Yeah, they didn't actually do. They didn't bloom, though. They should have been blooming now.
They're just blooming on it. One year, out Riverside, I had a community garden plot that was 12 feet wide and 120 feet long.
Wow.
And it took me 3 years to clear up the bluegrass.
See?
And the first year we did 3 feet. Partner. Here's your main partner who did it in 40 feet. For the third year, we built the whole thing. So that's our space, but we just use corn, we had melons, we had both cantaloupes, muskmelon, all that stuff. We need a squash, and Tara will go for it.
It's
easy to play on the street.
It's big, it's big, you can't do it.
We're going to try it. But I wanted to get the rooting on my peppers, so I thought, well, listen, I'll put my peppers in the same room, and I'll cover them with these 7 liter plastic bottles.
Okay.
And I got a good cold rain, and they never got bigger than this. All season. But I'm trying to go too early with my peppers.
Yeah.
And so with this cold weather, I was a little worried that I might have any good, but then I know it's just in the last couple days that they've coming out of this cold snow.
Might have put out a whole bunch of flowers, but they haven't bloomed yet, but they're coming, and you know,
maybe that's on there.
Yeah, there's a little bit of them, they were maybe, they were behind.
Okay, I want to remind our viewers that we're live and on the air, and if you have any questions, you can call us up at 1-800-339-1193. This is a chance to ask an old season gardener in his tricks and his plant problems that he needs. So give us a call, and let's talk about your garden, too. Now, in terms of pest management, what are your biggest problems in terms of pests? Is it vermiculous? Do you think the squirrels and the birds are your biggest problems? Or do you have more problems with the insects?
insects or with plant diseases?
Well, I think that in my case, I think that our biggest ones are the squirrels and the gophers. The birds, you know, the birds do so much good for us.
Slice me in the
So friendly, sick, and spirit.
That's why you see a lot of commercial animals are torn out by about 20 years when you're planting, you know, green seeds. And also, you can come in and find these.
city is.
How would they want to claw to you 3 to 4 feet of water per year? And you drive down the street and it's looking at horse front yard, long, as far as you can see. So pulls the water is coming out about 60-70% is what I'm asking.
Right. I would say that. But the biggest user of water in the city of Los Angeles is swimming pools. It evaporates far more than anything else in the city.
Lawns use far more water than
it's worth.
I'm going to thank everyone for listening. I'd like to thank everyone for listening. I'd like to thank you all for coming. Go on here. Don't keep on the sound. That's right. If I can